Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being together with him, we ask you, brothers, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by a spirit or a spoken word or a letter seeming to be from us, to the effect that the Lord, the day of the Lord has come. Let no one deceive you in any way, for the day will not come unless the rebellion comes first. And the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against ever so called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And you know what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan, with all power and all signs and wonders, and with all wicked deception for those who are perishing, because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. Therefore, God sends them a strong delusion so that they may believe what is false, in order that they may be condemned, who did not believe the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we ought always to give thanks to God for you, brothers, beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits to be saved, through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. So this he called you through our gospel, so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers, stand firm and hold to the traditions that you are taught by us, either by our Spirit spoken word or by our letter. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us tender comfort and good hope, through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. Amen. That's a good chunk of scripture. Praise the Lord. As we can see, and maybe we can go into that time, God is revealing, because revelation is progressive, he is revealing a chronology, something that will happen in the end times, and Paul is correcting and communicating it to the church. As we just read, there was some confusion in the church because of something particular, which I will mention soon. But may I remind you that in chapter 1, Paul was praising the Christians in Thessalonica because of their spiritual growth and their acts of love. It's like a church, a very young church, who was surrounded by persecution, even surrounded by false witnesses, holding on to their faith, holding on to the truth that Paul had communicated with them, where he spent just a few weeks personally with them, and he made reference to these as I had told you. So in chapter 2, Paul is correcting this discouragement that came within the church, and he was assuring the church, the Thessalonian church, that rapture had not yet happened. And I would like to place this in your lap today. Imagine if we get an email or a message on our church thread saying that, good morning brethren, I will have to inform you that the rapture has happened and we were left behind. Pastor Joseph Ajuz, God bless you. What would you say? What would you do? Don't you think we will be just extra confused and what's happening? How am I going to digest this? And this is what the church in Thessalonica experienced. Someone in the church writing, and by the way, that wasn't Pastor George Hughes who wrote the email or the thread. Someone from the church sort of went through the cracks and sort of did a false witness and placing the name of Pastor George so that he can look okay. But that's what happened. Somewhere within, some false prophet in the church communicated with the church that the rapture has happened and we are just here in tribulation. I mean, Paul had corrected that in a way where he said that for the day of the Lord to happen, to start up, because the day of the Lord is a season. It's like it involves the rapture, it involves the second coming and the millennium reign of Christ. Did not happen yet because for this catastrophic time to start, to begin, two things had to happen, two particular things had to happen. First was a widespread spiritual apostasy, the falling away from the faith. I mean, we can see this happening today, we can see this happening in certain churches where pastors are not preaching the gospel, are not preaching the truth, are not preaching repentance, they are just providing entertainment to their, not congregation, but their audience, as to say. And this is where we can identify that this widespread spiritual apostasy has already started. Something else that has to happen, and we have to experience, is the rise of a satanically empowered figure. The political system of the world is shifting, and we can see that shift is shifting into full control of every person. And this will happen from one source, as scripture tells us. And it is a person. And this person, according to Matthew, according to Daniel, firstly, Matthew and Revelations, is the Antichrist. So the Antichrist is not going to have horns. He is not going to have a tail. He is going to be a very smart person. And he will promise the world of good things, and actually he will find solution, political solutions to the world. It will work and the people will believe him. Now, here comes the crux. As Maltese people, even not Maltese, we are quite politically charged. You agree? we are quite charged politically. So if we have a partisan mindset, this is a great disadvantage, because first the scripture tells us that we shouldn't be people of parties, because we belong to the kingdom of God. But then it could be a disadvantage, because when this political system is shifting, we will not be able to see clearly what choices we should make in our lives. And as a church, politically, sort of partisan political mindsets are not compatible in the church. They cannot be compatible. And that's why scripture tells us so. This revelation, progressive revelation that Paul is communicating to the churches, the chronology of these last end times are being unfolded here to a church that did not have Bibles. They did not have Bibles as we have. They did not have the full revelation of scripture as we have. It was still being unfolded. So, I would like to concentrate today about not on the man of lawlessness, as scripture calls him, the Antichrist, the man who does not have the qualities to withstand morality. He does not have any good qualities in him. In fact, he is lawless. Imagine if we had these characteristics. Do you think they will be compatible with the life that God called us to live? This is very dangerous, and scripture will show us through what we're going to see today that certain Christians, and I ask you, brethren, listen to me please, certain Christians will be deceived in thinking that they are Christians. And we will see later on how Jesus responds to these people. So, I would like to concentrate on the qualities of this man, because these qualities, they provide sort of us to make a distinction between what qualities should I have as a Christian, and what qualities should I put far away from me as a Christian? Just cut myself from. And to be lawless, as a definition, is to be contrary to the law or to act without regard to the law. This is the quality that this system and this man will have. So, in a sinful world, law is necessary, and God knew that. Obviously, in the Old Testament, we see that God, the first guide He gave to His people were actually the law. And I would like to quote scripture from 1 Timothy, chapter 1, verse 9. And it says, "For the law was not intended for people who do what is right. It is for people who are lawless and rebellious, who are ungodly and sinful, who consider nothing sacred and defile what is holy, who kill their father and mother, or commit other murders." These are the qualities of a person who is lawless. So, in a while we will, you know, just know our departure as humans before God. So those who choose to act lawlessly, they are providing or communicating sin in the world, this quality of sin. The word for lawlessness in the Bible is often translated as iniquity. So, according to the Bible, the root of the word lawlessness is rebellion. So, the quality that this man will harbor is a quality that we have to make sure is not part of our lives. And scripture makes that very, very clear. In John 3, verse 4, here scripture is defining sin as lawlessness. And it says, and I quote, "Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness." So can you familiarize yourself now? The picture is becoming a bit clearer for us to see these qualities. To commit sin is to be lawless, that is. So sin, the sinner, breaks God's law. In this way, lawlessness is the rejection of God. These are the qualities that we can see around us. Already, they are present. These qualities, if we speak to people on social media, on whatever, or during your work, or during any circumstance in your life, you will see that this quality is already present in people. And the fact that they are rebelling, as scripture says, against God's design, they are going against God's law, the world is even legalizing sin, it's like it's making lawlessness legal. Can you see what's happening in the political system of the world? So Satan, who models the ultimate rejection of God, will one day, as we saw in scripture, empower the Antichrist, called the lawless one, whose rise to power will be accordance with how Satan works. So this man who will sort of bring to fulfillment all this evil that there is in the world, he will be the one who will harbor all this evil, and the power that he will use is coming directly from Satan. He will also show us signs and wonders and miracles, okay? And the people will believe. So for us to discern this political system, for us to discern this apostasy, because this is something that we will experience as a church, it is important for us to know these qualities, because when we do our homework, as to say, when we have to discern on what's happening and what decisions we will be taking, it is important that we will not form part of these qualities. In fact, this can translate itself in simpler things. It sometimes, as I said before, in the church, as we saw in Thessalonica, there were people who were faithful to God, and there were people who had hidden agendas to cause confusion, be false witnesses. And I believe that this is still present today, unfortunately. But we have to make sure where we are lined up, where our life is lined up. Are we in the church Are you Christians, as Paul was praising the Thessalonians for standing by their faith? Are we showing that we are of the faith? Are we showing that we belong to the kingdom of God? And this can start, brethren, with a very simple way of seeing things. How committed am I in the church? How important is the church appointment for me? This should be something that I find joy in. I find my delight in the church. And it's like when I love swimming, for example. I love going to the beach, and I don't. But I see people that for them to find a good place in Adira Bay, okay, they start their voyage at 6 o'clock in the morning, so that they will arrive early, they will park their car comfortably, unload whatever they need, and spend the day there. And I can see when there are people, and I say, what? So you go that early and spend the day in the sun, on the sand. Okay. Very committed for me, that person is very committed. So when I see brethren in the church who do not arrive on time, that gives me another definition. How committed are we to the time that we have in the church of worship and sharing the word? We should be committed, and it has to show, brethren. It has to show when we are committed. Lawlessness is contrasted with righteousness in verses such as Romans 6, Corinthians 2, Corinthians 6, and Hebrews 1. Cannot share these scriptures. And I encourage you that if you want to listen to the sort of continuation of the sermon in the Bible study, I encourage that this is another sign of my commitment to the church, of my commitment in showing what kind of Christian I am. It is important for us to be present in all the church appointments. Come on. How simple is that? I mean, it's either I am that type of person, I am that type of person, it's either I am all in, or else I'm not there. I am that type of person, okay? It's either I'm in the heart, or else I'm out. This is something that we see through scripture, and we see even in our experiences. It's like people are somewhere near the main door of the church, spiritually that is. It's either they are in or out, not really sure where I stand. So if you are living your faith in this periphery, in this area, you will be in great danger of ending up like those Christians who thought they were Christians and went before Jesus, and they heard what we're going to see later on. I praise God for that we can hear these words now, in the time of grace, in the time that we have space for change. Because when Jesus quoted what these people thought that they were in him, but they weren't, did not have the space to change anything. So the righteous who have the nature of Jesus Christ hate the deeds of lawlessness. We literally step ourselves, we hate sin. We hate our past life when we were without Christ. We do not look back, as scripture tells us. We have to look forward, because we have we have a destination. We have somewhere to go, and this stands on the promises of God. So I have to be focused. facing forward. We have the hope of glory. That keeps us going. So, I mentioned Lot, a godly man living in Sodom, in Scripture, and I quote, Peter quoted what Lot said about his country. It was full of evil, it was sinful, it was lawless, and this is what Lot said. I quote 2 Peter 2:8. He was tormented in his righteous soul by the lawless deeds he saw and heard. This is what he stood by his faith, and he could see a distinction between what he was in God and what those people were in lawlessness. And we have to see this distinction in our lives. Because this distinction, these scriptures, will keep us on track. It's important that we keep on track. The psalmist said, and I quote Psalm 26, verse 5, I abhor the assembly of evildoers and refuse to sit with the wicked. This is what qualities we should have. Christians are to be law abiding. Peter said that in this verse there. So we have to make sure that we know our identity. We know God's will for us. And we have to adjust our lives with God's will. And we have to be living members of the church. For the church to be effective, for the church to be healthy, for the church to give glory to God, we have to be all living members. Because, you know, it's like when you have a dead member, when you say, when you sit sort of improperly and there's low blood flow and you can't even walk on your feet. We shouldn't be that type of member, you know, because it will hinder God's work. So, when a society ignores the law, lawlessness is the result, and chaos follows. So, in the time of Judges, after Joshua's death, there was a time it was marked by disorder and oppression. And I quote from Judges, chapter 21, verse 25. And Samuel says this, in those days, Israel had no king. In those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as they saw fit. So hence, there was disorder and oppression. So we cannot stand, brethren, without loving the law of God. We cannot stand. There will be no order in our spiritual life. Sometimes that is why we find ourselves needing prayer, because something is not wrong, it is not right in our destination. We could have lost track. And opportunities like this will give us a clear picture on how to adjust. For example, the riot in Ephesus is a good example of lawlessness in action. We find this in Acts chapter 19. The rioters were confused and unsure even of why they were rioting. Verse 32. They were rioting, but they did not know why. This is the riot in Ephesus. That's what lawlessness makes people do. That's what they do. We have no direction. We have no identity if we do not stick to what Scripture is telling us. So God has a purpose for establishing human government. So God is using politicians also to establish order on earth. Even though that there might be some questions here, But yes, God is still doing this because Scripture says so. And I quote. The last part of the First Peter chapter 2, the government is to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. This is even in God's plan, you know. Whoever the leader is in a country, God is ensuring order with that government. So in other words, lawlessness is condemned in Scripture. And there is another scripture which I would like to quote in Romans 30. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. So this is something that brings a light on what's going to happen in the end times. So it is important that we know where we stand. The Bible connects man's lawlessness now, because that's where we were. When we were without Christ, that's where we were. But the Bible connects man's lawlessness and rebellion against God with his need, with the need of God's forgiveness. And we see this, Paul quoted this in Romans chapter 4. He was quoting Psalm 32, in fact, where he said, blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are forgiven. Now, this is coming to the church. Now it is coming to the church. Blessed are we. Because once we were lawless people, but God forgave us. He covered our sins. And that's what we are supposed to be. That's who we are supposed to be. It is not something out of this world for us to feel spiritually tired. But we have to stand by our faith. It's important in a time that is so close, because we can already see apostasy happening. We can already see the political system of the world is changing in a way that, wow, we are saying we can see the Bible unfolding before our eyes. Isn't that true? We can see it unfolding. So this is a time where we have to be vigilant. We have to open our eyes. And I remember Jesus telling his disciples, pray so that you will not fall into temptation. Pray. Blessed are those, and I say again, whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Brethren, God's righteousness was imputed on us. God's righteousness, when God called us out of a crowd, and everyone has this experience, this witness, I'm sure. When God called you by name out of the crowd, and he recognized your sin, you repented, and you submitted to Christ, Jesus imputed his righteousness in you. So Jesus, from lawless people, made us righteous people. And that is what and who we should be. That is the church. As Paul said, that there is someone who is restricting, holding back the evil one from coming to office. Yes, that is the Holy Spirit. But let us not forget that we are temples of the Holy Spirit. So that is the church as well. So our contribution in society, our evangelism in society, is another form of restricting evil from taking a high place until the time comes. There is an appointed time in everything. But for now, the Holy Spirit through us is restricting evil and our presence in the world, and our identity as a church is important. We are all responsible to convey what the Holy Spirit wants to do through us. Restricting evil, like speaking the truth during work, making a correction because of something immoral, even on social media. We voice the truth on social media. That is even the action of the church. That is the action of Christians in the world. That is what Jesus wanted us to continue after he went back to the Father. In fact, I was talking to Pastor Joe after the first service, and he reminded me. And I want to share this with you. There are two neighbors in my street that who are homosexuals. They live together. We talk. I mean, nothing wrong about that. But the fact that when they see us, once, because I talk with one of them, I talk quite. We have conversations together, and he said he knows that I know that you do not agree with this, Ed, but I want to tell you something. Please, can I share with you? Yeah, sure, share. But they, when they see us, they hold back a bit. They are judged without even speaking a word. And he's on my back garden. I have a wall, and I fixed a scripture there about 9 years ago. Now it's time for me to change it because the sun has baked it. John 3:16 in Maltese. And once he came to me and he was pointing fingers at me and said, "Who do you think you are?" This guy. I told him, "What did I do? Who do you think you are? Putting scriptures?" Well, I told him, "That's my wall, so I can put it if I want." And he was really angry at me because I put a scripture up there. That is how the Holy Spirit is restricting evil, and God will be speaking to those two people because they know that what they do is not right. And when they see us, God reminds them. That is who and what the church is. We are forming, holding back what is not true. And we do that in the power of Christ. So, as I said, Jesus imputed in us his righteousness. He took away our sin, imputed his righteousness. To redeem us, Titus chapter 2, I am going to quote, to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. So this is our quality. We are people who are zealous for good works. And this is the exact opposite of the philosophy of the Antichrist. That is the church. We are zealous for good works. And that is what brings glory to God. When we are people, obedient people, doing his will out there. And doing our obligations in here also. Because we can give nothing if we are not receiving. Nothing. Practically nothing. So our lawless deeds resulted in Christ's death. But God's grace overcomes our lawless hearts. This is the truth. This is what the church is. And so you can make me conclude, as you see these scriptures unfolding one after the other, that the lawless one is the enemy of the church. The lawless one is the opposite of the identity of the church. And I praise God that God will pick us up before this guy comes to office, because it's not going to be easy. But I believe that we will see this government form, this political system, this philosophy. We do not know exactly how it's going to happen. Apostasy, we know how it's happening. It's not only the falling away, the rebellion is happening outside the church. The rebellion is happening inside the church. You know? I mean, the world has managed to enter into the church instead of the world going to the church, going to the world and proclaim the truth. So, why does this happen? Because we lack action. We lack action. That's why it happens. And we have to make sure, brethren, that we do not cause a weakening in the church. In God's judgment, many will stand before Christ claiming a connection with Him that exists only in their own minds. This is the part that I had mentioned before. This is the part I will be concluding with. There are Christians, many whom I evangelize, they start to joke around sometimes and they say, I have a guarantee that I will be in heaven. God is gracious, and they start joking around, you know, and I just hold back for a while, and then I try to bring them to their senses. But those are unbelievers. You expect an unbeliever to be deceived, but I do not expect a church member to be deceived. It's not even an option for me. But Jesus said that it is. And there will be people who are rehearsing, as scripture tells us, before Jesus their good deeds done in His name. And Jesus will declare to them, workers of lawlessness. That's how He calls them. Workers of lawlessness. I'm quoting Matthew 7. I quote the whole scripture. But I will reply after they rehearse their good deeds, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's law. Oh my. I wouldn't want to hear those words. I'm sure that even you wouldn't want to hear these words. But this is real. Jesus is telling us this. This is a warning to the church. Make sure that you know where you stand. Make sure that you know the identity that God has promised you. Make sure that you have that faith. Make sure that you are in Christ. Because if you are not, you have to come to Him now, before the next minute. Now, before the next minute. Because salvation, our salvation is today. So, Jesus is giving us a warning here that it breaks me. You know? This warning is something that I've been afraid of since I was still a charismatic renewal member. I used to read scripture, and when I used to read this, it used to turn me to pieces. Wow. This scripture, brethren, is not a scripture that God is punishing us with. This scripture is a scripture that will keep us on track. We have to keep on track. We have to make sure that we are really committed, We have to make sure that our faith is authentic, as Paul prays the Thessalonians as being authentic believers. We have to make sure, and this is the responsibility of every one of us here, we have to make sure that our identity is true. So let us not sort of listen to this warning Jesus is giving us and just say, it shouldn't be like that. We have to adjust ourselves, making sure that we are the Church of Christ. Do not lean on how good your pastor is. Do not lean on how good the sermons are. Do not lean on how good the worship is. Lean deep in your heart and see if you are in Christ. Because the time is going to be difficult, and the lawless one will deceive even those in the church, if need be, if they are not on track. This is a challenge that breaks my heart. This is a challenge that I have challenged myself with before I came up here. Believe me, I know what responsibility I have when I speak the word of God from up here. It's like when I come to preach, it's like I'm really nervous. It reminds me of when I was in college and the teacher sends me to the headmaster's office. And we used to stand there. I remember there was this, like a screen, I mean, very primitive, but it had a red light and a green light. So, engage, come in. And we were sweating and praying outside his office, because we wouldn't want to see that red light or green light come on. And it reminded me of how scared I am to preach something like this. It's not easy. And obviously then we went at the office and we get a meeting. That was very, very sort of regular for me. But I was still afraid. Yeah. Brethren, it's not easy to listen to these words, but we have to keep on track. We have to adjust our lives and say, listen, Lord, I live for you. We have to really take it in our hearts that we are called by Jesus himself to live a holy life. And even when we fail, we come back again, we ask for forgiveness, we ask for his strength, and carry on. Stand by our faith. Matthew 13. I close with this scripture, verse 41 to 43, and it says, the Son of Man will send his angels, and they will remove from his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. And the angels will throw them in the fiery furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in their Father's kingdom. This is the church.